Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Innocent Victims, The True Story of the Eastburn Family Murders, by Scott Whisnant. Narrated by Chris Andrew Ciulla. Chapter 1. The phone rang early Sunday morning at an hour when nothing good ever came from a ringing phone. Bob Seafelt groaned. Just as he expected, one of his soldiers was in jail. An argument with his wife had gotten out of hand, greased considerably by liquor. She wasn't about to bail him out. His sergeant would have to. "This shouldn't take long," Seafelt told his wife as he climbed out of bed. He trudged to the car, flipped on his headlights, and drove the half-mile to Fort Bragg, the largest military base in the nation. Seafelt found his man sulking in the brig. God, he was sick of that look. He haggled with the MPs and shepherded the kid to daylight. Irritated and needing a shave, Seafelt pulled into his driveway just before noon. Jeanette waited in the yard. "What's going on over there?" Seafelt asked his wife. No one stirred next door at the Eastburns' house. Their Toyota station wagon hadn't budged for 3 days. Katie Eastburn hadn't taken her 3 girls to church or even bothered to pick up the Fayetteville Times that morning. The Sunday paper lay rolled up in the front yard beside 2 others. Seafelt thought that was strange. A day didn't go by without him watching those girls romp on the backyard jungle gym. Katie would watch from the back steps, waving at Seafelt as he came home from work.
"Hey, Bob,"
Erin would holler.
"Look what I can do."
Seafelt would look up and find the 3-year-old, a persistent climber, perched high in the backyard dogwood tree. Jana, her toddler sister, would stand by the fence that separated the 2 yards and hold out her arms until Seafelt picked her up and hugged her. "Want a cookie?" he'd ask. Katie would nod that it was all right, and he'd take the girls inside, where he and Jeanette would let them pick their favorite kind. He thought back to Thursday, the last time he'd seen Katie. She'd come over just after dark to borrow milk, bringing Erin and Jana and leaving Kara asleep in bed. Bob offered the girls some popcorn, and Katie wound up staying 30 minutes before checking Kara. He remembered how she sat in the corner rocking chair, talking about missing her husband the last 2 months. The girls finished their popcorn, and Katie got up to leave, Jana in one arm and a glass of milk in her free hand. That was the last he'd heard from her. By Saturday, Seafelt mentioned it to Jeanette, but they let it drop. Katie had talked about taking the girls to see their father, Captain Gary Eastburn, at Air Force Officer School in Montgomery, Alabama. "She must have put them on the bus," Jeanette said. That night, Cumberland County Sheriff's Deputy Brenda Price shook Seafelt awake as he dozed on his couch. Had he noticed anything unusual next door? Seafelt, too groggy to ask why, said no. Nothing was the matter. The deputy left, and a weary Seafelt turned off the light and went to bed. But by Sunday morning, he was worried about those newspapers piled up, the car in the same place, and the stroller next to the side door, where it had been for 3 days. "I'm going over there to see if anyone's home," he told his wife. He picked up the Sunday paper, dated May 12, 1985, and tossed it and the others into the carport. He sidestepped the baby stroller and knocked on the side door. No answer. Then he rang the front doorbell a few times. Nothing. He rang it again. A baby cried. Seafelt thought it sounded like Jana, 21 months old. He rang the doorbell again. Another cry. Katie Eastburn couldn't possibly have left her toddler alone in the house. Seafelt wondered if he heard right. But what else sounds like a baby crying? He called Jeanette over to see if she could hear the cry. He rang again. "That's the baby," Jeanette said. "Call somebody," Seafelt instructed with more confidence than he felt. Jeanette fumbled through the phone book, but the pages shook in her hands. She found a listing for Julie Zerniak, the Eastburns' babysitter who lived a few houses away. "Julie, I think something terrible has happened," she said. Julie gave her the Eastburns' number, and Jeanette called. The phone rang and rang. "Please let her answer," Jeanette whispered. She let it ring some more. She next tried the Cumberland County Sheriff's Department. At 12:53 p.m., the dispatcher relayed a child neglect call. Deputy William Toman was patrolling nearby on Santa Fe Drive, checking stores along Bragg Boulevard until his shift ended. He heard the call and figured he was closer to Summer Hill than anyone. Toman told the dispatcher he'd handle it and arrived 4 minutes later at 367 Summer Hill Road. Julie beat Toman to the house. "Jan is standing there in a crib," she told Seafelt. "Why wasn't someone going in to get her?" Julie ran to the back of the house and tried to open a bedroom window. "Don't touch nothing," Seafelt hollered. "Just go on," Julie told him. "I want to get in and find out." Deputy Toman showed up in no mood for nonsense. The sheriff's department had procedures to follow on child neglect calls, and Toman was not one to stray from procedures. He tried to make sense of what Julie was saying, then dismissed her as loud and irrational. Something about a child in a crib. Seafelt was still irritated that Julie was trying to break into the house. "All right, I'll handle it from here," Toman said, before they could worry him further. Toman checked all the doors and windows. No forced entry. He found a note jammed inside the storm door. "Mrs. Eastburn, get in touch with your husband by phone. Deputy Price." Toman shrugged and rang the doorbell. No one stirred. No baby cried. Seafelt felt a little foolish. Neighbors began to gather in the street. Toman's sergeant drove up and was talking to the young deputy on the front porch. "What do you think we should do?" the sergeant asked. Toman wasn't sure. Then he heard the crying. He leaned over the porch railing, pressed his nose to the bedroom window, and cupped his hands at his temples. Little Jana Eastburn stood in her crib, her arms outstretched to anyone. "I've got no choice," Toman told his sergeant. "I've got to go in." Toman stepped over the railing, sliced the screen, and lifted the window. He poked his head in and smelled death. Jana wanted out of that room. Her white pajamas with blue and yellow flowers reeked. She was pale and gaunt, her eyes puffy from so much crying. A slew of stuffed animals and toys had been placed in her crib, as if someone expected Jana to need entertaining for a while. She had tossed them onto the floor. Jana wrapped both arms around Toman's neck, digging her tiny fingers into his back. "It's all right," he told her. "It'll be all right." He passed Jana out the window to Seafelt and found a neatly stacked pile of Pampers next to the crib, along with a bottle. He handed the diapers and bottle to Seafelt and turned to face the rest of the house. The smell was getting stronger. He steeled himself for a grisly body count. "It didn't matter how many bodies I found," he would say later. "I was more worried about what I was going to find alive." Toman drew his gun and opened the door. He looked to his right, toward the master bedroom. 3-year-old Erin Eastburn lay beside her parents' bed, the bottom half of her body protruding from under a white nightgown with delicate lavender stripes and bows. A pillow leaned against her face. The nightstand beside the bed had been knocked over. The knife had nearly severed the child's head. Toman walked around the edge of the bed. A hand reached from behind it, grasping at nothing. He looked over the bed and saw Kathryn Eastburn, nude, stabbed, and dead. A pillow covered her face. Toman lifted it and saw the 31-year-old mother's throat had been slashed in the same manner as her daughter's, her chest wounds an angry afterthought. Toman backed out of the room and into Jana's bedroom, where no one had died, a room he could trust. He leaned out the window, a handkerchief over his face, and called for an ambulance. The stench had filtered outside the window. "Is it what I think it is?" Seafelt asked. He recognized Jana's pajamas as the one she'd been wearing in his living room Thursday night. Has that baby been alone 3 nights? He wondered. I'm not going to discuss it until the detectives come, Toman told Seafelt. The deputy walked through the living room, where a laundry basket filled with folded clothes had been overturned. Some newspapers were scattered about. Kathryn Eastburn's sneakers, still tied, were in the middle of the floor. Her pink blouse was crumpled on the floor. There had been a struggle, Toman thought, but not much of one. The furniture was still in place, and even toys on the floor had not been disturbed. 3 miles away, a group of paramedics and firemen huddled around a television at the Yadkin Road Volunteer Fire Department to watch a Celtic 76er playoff game. The call came just before tip-off. One DOA, the dispatcher said solemnly. Some old boy had a heart attack, William Huggins, chief paramedic on duty, told his partner. But there was more. Now the dispatcher was saying, two DOA. That's not good, Huggins thought. Two people don't usually die in the same house at the same time. Huggins' ambulance pulled into the Eastburn driveway without sirens blaring or tires screeching. An ashen Toman greeted him by the side door. The senior paramedic, Toman announced, would have to go inside. Huggins realized that would be him. Huggins followed Toman inside to the back bedroom, where he saw the lifeless body of Erin Eastburn. It was his job to officially declare the obvious. Erin had been yanked off her parents' bed and onto her back, her knees up in the air, so that, as Huggins said later, it looked like sex. She'd been there a long time. In 10 years as a paramedic, Huggins had gotten used to gruesome sights, but this child, angelic face, sparkling brown eyes, and throat hacked to pieces, was something he'd never forget. Huggins put the back of his hand against Erin's mouth. Then he picked up her pale, cool arm and checked for a pulse. He finally found a place between wounds on her chest for the stethoscope. He nodded to Toman and went through the same routine with her mother. Then he turned, got out of the house, dropped to his knees, and gagged. "Has everybody in there been accounted for?" he asked no one in particular, still on his knees. "There's 3 children and the mother," Seafelt said. "I've only seen 2. "Then there's another one that's been kidnapped or something," Seafelt said. Toman ran back inside the house and came back seconds later. "I've found another one." Huggins went inside, this time to the bedroom across from Jana's. He sidestepped a plastic buggy full of toys, a copy of Raggedy Ann lying on top, and a toy piano. He moved past Erin's bed, empty except for Big Bird tucked under a sheet, and approached the bed against the far wall. Underneath the Star Wars bedspread, Kara Eastburn stared blankly at the ceiling, her throat cut. Everyone was accounted for. The somber news spread quickly outside the house, more with nods and sighs than words. Toman helped another deputy roll crime scene ribbon around the Eastburns' lawn. Detectives called away from Sunday dinners with their families met in the driveway. The nondescript 3-bedroom house, red brick with black shutters and ornamental iron railing, was now a curiosity. Neighbors walked over. Children stopped in the street on their bicycles and leaned on 1 foot. Television crews started filming. Most of the neighbors knew the Eastburns lived there, but not much else. In this tranquil, tree-lined military neighborhood, just off a main road into Fort Bragg, families transferred in and out at the whim of the federal government. Some knew the Eastburns as that nice young family. The mother was quiet and reserved, always tending to her blonde, brown-eyed daughters. They never harmed anyone. The Fayetteville-Fort Bragg part of North Carolina has always had a high murder rate. The area teems with teenage boys away from home for the first time. They go to bars and get in trouble. They commit violent crimes. The residents are almost used to it. But not in Summerhill, an upper-middle-class neighborhood usually reserved for higher-ranking officers. And not this kind of crime. Nobody gets used to that anywhere. Cumberland County Sheriff's detectives met and discussed what they had. A military captain's wife and two young daughters stabbed to death in their home. Fort Bragg has been the site of the same kind of family slayings, 4.5 miles down the road, 15 years earlier. Onlookers began to buzz before stretchers had taken the bodies out of the house. "Oh, my God, this is just like the MacDonald killings all over again," one said to another. Just 2 months earlier, Jeffrey MacDonald had attempted another appeal for a new trial, still claiming drug-crazed hippies had killed his pregnant wife and two daughters. But a federal judge had disagreed and ruled that the Green Beret doctor was right where he needed to be, in prison for 3 counts of murder. Interest in the MacDonald killings had peaked in the mid-1980s with the release of the movie Fatal Vision, based on the book of the same name. For millions of television viewers, the slayings had represented a debate of whether a man who appeared so good could be so evil. But for people living in the Fort Bragg area, the slayings had meant locked windows, bolted doors, and raw fear. As neighbors watched the ambulances arrive at the Eastburn home, they looked at each other and wondered, how could the same barbarous act happen again in this town? What if the killer lives in the neighborhood? What if he's among us now? Chapter 2. Detective Jack Watts knew his assignment. Find the killer and find him quickly. Sheriff Otis Jones, in the midst of a re-election bid, didn't need an unsolved triple murder case to drag around the campaign trail. He put Watts and 3 other detectives on the Eastburn case full-time and asked his 29 other detectives to start checking their sources. 7 agents from the State Bureau of Investigation were called to help. Sheriff Jones wanted the answer to have nothing to do with Jeffrey MacDonald. The sooner his detectives made an arrest, the less likely rumors of a MacDonald copycat murder would turn to full-scale hysteria. Detective Watts ran his fingers through his graying hair and looked around the Eastburn crime scene. In 14 years with the Sheriff's Department, he'd seen the military youth of this town do some strange things. By day, they were nothing more than walking wallets to merchants, the lifeblood of the economy of Fayetteville, a city of 60,000. At night, many of those dollars went to beer joints and topless bars. For these young boys taught to fight by the military, many of them away from home for the first time, the combination could have shattering results. Watts had seen one awful murder after another, but slitting a 3-year-old child's throat was beyond their drunken brawls. Watts had something different this time. A group of detectives and ID techs huddled in the Eastburn's front yard. Watts knew the killer was already days ahead of them, so their search of the house would be crucial. "It's bad in there, fellas," he said, trying to brace them for the grueling task ahead. ID technicians usually practiced dark humor at the murder scene, stopping at times to speculate whether the body had fooled around once too often or tried to fleece his drug dealer again. But no one would joke inside 367 Summerhill Road this Mother's Day. They got on their hands and knees and picked over the house. For 4 hours, they worked over and around the bodies, collecting pieces of the family's final night together. Katie's sock, Erin's pillow, Kara's bedspread. Conrad Wrench was the photographer of the group. He took pictures of the girls from several angles, then of Katie's nude body. He grimaced when it came time to move their bodies and look underneath. Perhaps he'd uncover some part of the killer, a strand of hair or a piece of skin. Disturbing 5-year-old Kara was bad enough. The killer had found white quilt batting and placed it on her chest. ID tech Bruce Dawes lifted it, getting cotton fibers on his hands. He couldn't touch it without fibers coming loose. Then Dawes looked down and noticed Kara had been stabbed until her organs broke through her skin. Moving Erin was worse. Dawes picked her up so Wrench could take another picture and watched in horror as her head slumped over and nearly rolled off. Slashing her throat had not been enough. The killer had gone to the trouble to cut nearly all the way around. For 3 throat-slashing murders, The house had surprisingly little blood. There were obvious stains under the bodies, but almost no blood had splattered onto the walls. They continued their tour of the scene, finding evidence in odd places. A tie back from a living room curtain was found in Kara's room. A piece of white rope was found in the middle of Summerhill Road, back toward Yadkin Road. Someone had been in the utility room, leaving an empty Glad bag box on top of the dryer. They put about 2 dozen pieces of evidence into bags, among them head hairs from both bedrooms. They vacuumed the house and collected the bags. From the master bedroom, they took a sheet and bedspread with bloody ribbed impressions, as if someone's corduroy pants had brushed against it. Fingerprint examiner John Trogdon found prints on door frames almost 7 feet from the floor. A palm print next to a bloody smear was found above the living room door. That night, the State Bureau of Investigation sent its lab experts to spray the house with luminol. Brenda Dew and Pam Tully pulled a blanket over them and created a walking tent, spraying luminol and waiting for a reaction from the chemical, which caused blood and some metallic objects, such as straight pins, to glow. The luminol explained why the house hadn't been covered in blood. The killer had spent considerable time covering his tracks. Luminol reactions suggested he had wiped the bathroom sink, doorknobs, and light switches. A towel and washcloth, soaked in blood, had been dropped near the master bathroom door. The luminol further revealed a path of bloody left footprints leading into the master bedroom. Perhaps the killer had carelessly stepped 1 foot in blood as he cleaned up. There were more luminol footprints on the front porch and others leading from the carport down the driveway. How had they survived rain on Saturday and Sunday? Some of those hairs and prints should match the killer, Watts thought. The department later released a statement saying, "If the killer left so much as a hair, we're going to find it. It's hard to do that much damage without leaving a part of yourself." But the killer had left behind one piece of evidence that had already confounded Watts. Wrench had found a rubber glove tip in a doorway between the living room and hallway, a tip that obviously hadn't come from a dishwashing glove or a technician's glove. It matched nothing in the house and had no reason to be there, unless someone left it there on purpose to mock investigators. Anyone familiar with fatal vision knew Army investigators had found the finger of a surgeon's glove in the MacDonald's bedroom, still fresh with Colette MacDonald's blood. The glove had been used to write the word pig on the headboard of the bed, just above where she had been stabbed and clubbed to death. Watts needed a witness to explain this away. He turned the investigation outside the house to anyone who could tell him about Kathryn Eastburn's final days. He started with Julie Zerniak, the 15-year-old babysitter still sobbing on the Seafelt's porch. "Julie, did anything unusual happen while you babysat?" Watts asked.
"I got these weird calls just about every time," she said.
Ever since Gary Eastburn left for officer school, the calls kept coming, she said. Mrs. Eastburn had even warned her about how to handle them. Julie told Watts that the last time she babysat was Tuesday. Somebody called and asked, "How was the most gorgeous girl on Summerhill Road?" "Did you know who it was?" Watts asked.
"Well, I can't remember, but he left a message. I took another message, too. Somebody named Angela wanted to buy their dog."
Julie explained that the family had planned to move to England and feared their dog, Dixie, wouldn't survive the trip. "What did you do with those messages?" Watts asked.
"She kept all her messages on the bulletin board over the phone. I guess that's where I put them."
Watts sent his men back inside the house to find the notes, but they came back empty-handed. "You sure you don't remember what they said?" he asked Julie again.
"No, sir. I wish I could, but I just can't."
Watts turned to leave.
"Better try again when she's not so distraught," he thought.
"It freaks me out," Julie said. "It's just like Dr. MacDonald."
Watts stopped and listened as the Eastburns' babysitter explained her friendship with Jeffrey MacDonald, a martyred hero in her eyes. Julie was a charter member of Jeffrey MacDonald's International Fan Club.
This isn't good, Watts thought.
First a strange glove tip, then a babysitter who idolized MacDonald. The friendship started in eighth grade, after she chose Fatal Vision for a book report. She had absorbed all 663 pages, reading some parts over and over. Jeffrey MacDonald, the Princeton graduate, Green Beret doctor, an all-American boy, couldn't have killed his wife and kids. She didn't understand how they could have so easily dismissed Helena Stokely, a drug-addled informant who confessed several times to witnessing the murders.
I don't think she'd confess to something like that for nothing, Julie said.
Julie's fascination with MacDonald didn't end with her book report. She wanted to know more about him, the book, and the case. She wanted to hear from him, find out for herself what he was like. Julie wrote to MacDonald at his Bastrop, Texas prison.
I'll understand if you don't write me back, she wrote.
A few days later, the first of more than a dozen letters from MacDonald arrived, punctuated through with smiley faces. It was good to hear from her, he wrote. He was working out with weights, trying to stay in shape, and reading medical journals. He said his chances for a new trial were good. Hope you're doing well in school, MacDonald wrote in another letter. When I get out, I'll have to come see you. Julie said she wanted to be MacDonald's third daughter. MacDonald agreed if he ever had another daughter, he'd want her to be like Julie. She espoused his innocence to anyone who asked, saying, Dr. MacDonald was not that type of person. She'd read Fatal Vision 7 times and decided it was filled with lies. I don't think you can really understand what I mean because you haven't talked to him and you haven't written him, you know, she said. And it's just the way he is. Joe McGinnis lied extensively through that book, as far as I know, what Dr. MacDonald has told me. And Dr. MacDonald is a very caring, sensitive person. And unless he was just totally freaked out somehow, he couldn't have done that in a normal state of mind. 10 weeks before the murders, Dr. MacDonald called Collect to wish Julie a happy 15th birthday. Julie told him she'd been kicked out of junior high school for getting caught with marijuana in her purse. Yeah, they handcuffed me like a murderer, she said. Oh, my God, I mean, Watts moved on to other witnesses, the ones who cared less about Jeffrey MacDonald. But none could shed any light on why someone butchered the Eastburn family. He left for home around midnight, resigned that he would spend time investigating a MacDonald copycat murder. He wished he had a better lead. Not long after Watts left the neighborhood, 20-year-old Patrick Cohn walked to the top of Summerhill Road and waited. Cohn knew when he saw those ambulances, he was going to have to tell what he saw. 3 nights earlier, he thought it was kind of funny. He told his dad. He told coworkers. He played it for laughs, never telling it the same way twice. That was before the bodies were found. Patrick Cohn now had to think this through. He wasn't sure he wanted to expose his private life to policemen. He always stayed out too late and drank too much. He was afraid his friends would think he'd turned fed. But he knew right from wrong. And he knew somebody might remember seeing him on the street that night. So Patrick Cohn did something he never thought he'd do. He started waving his arms as a sheriff's deputy turned into Summer Hill. Deputy Eddie Hollingsworth pulled over.
Man, I saw somebody leaving the house that night, Cohn told him.
Hollingsworth summoned the detectives before the young black man lost his nerve. Watts had just gotten home when he and Detective Robert Biddle were called back out to Summer Hill. Mr. Cohn, Watts began, could you tell us what you saw Thursday night?
I was walking home from my girlfriend's house about 3:30, Cohn said, describing a walk home that took him past the Eastburns' home and around the corner where he lived with his parents and sisters. As I was walking, I saw a white Chevette parked on the road. Then I saw this white dude walking down the lady's driveway. I passed right by him. He said, I'm getting an early start this morning, or something like that. Then I watched him get in his white Chevette and drive off.
Cohn said he could remember the man's face, his hair and mustache. He described a black jacket, a black hat, a white shirt, jeans, and tennis shoes. He remembered how the guy carried a garbage bag over his shoulder all the way to his car, 200 yards down from the Eastburns. Watts couldn't believe his good fortune. He didn't know much about Patrick Cohn, but he liked his story. He told Cohn he'd be in touch. Chapter 3 Air Force Captain Gary Eastburn stared at the phone. It should be ringing by now, he thought. He paced up and down the dormitory hallway. Then he sat down and stared some more. 8 o'clock in the morning. He and Katie had an arrangement. While he was gone 8.5 weeks at Squadron Officer School in Montgomery, Alabama, they would try to limit the phone calls to 1 a week. It was cheaper for Katie to call than for him to call collect. If she called early on Saturday, he could guard the hall phone next to his room and answer before it rang twice. Gary didn't like being separated any more than she did, but he had to do it. The Air Force had offered him the chance to go to Squadron Officer School for 3 months and learn about great leaders in military history. If an officer wanted to get promoted, he attended these schools. Gary had considered taking his wife and daughters with him, pulling Kara out of school and jamming them all into a trailer just off Maxwell Air Force Base in Montgomery. But he just couldn't do that to them. Besides, when he got back, they'd be just a few weeks from moving to England, a long-time fantasy of his. The Air Force was sending an officer to act as liaison with the British Air Force, a job Gary Eastburn had lobbied long and hard to get, so he could bear the 8.5 weeks of separation, by far the longest he and Katie had been apart in 10 years of marriage. From what Gary could tell, they had held up well. Katie called at 8 a.m. every Saturday and wrote during the week. The kids took turns on the phone when she called. When Katie put Jana on the phone, she thought her father was inside the telephone, sometimes pointing at it and saying, "Da-da." He'd even stopped worrying about the phone call she'd gotten about a week after he left. About 4 a.m., someone had awoken Katie. "What are you doing tonight?" "Who's this?"
"Mrs. Eastburn, I live around the corner. I'm coming to see you," the caller said.
Katie slammed down the phone and stared at her bedroom walls until it was time to get Kara up for school. Gary hadn't thought about that call for a while. His mind was on the hall phone in his dormitory. As soon as it rang, Gary would tell Katie he'd be home by this time next week. "I'll miss you tomorrow on Mother's Day," he'd say. Katie must be getting Kara ready for one of the gymnastic shows her class staged. Gary's oldest daughter could do somersaults and handstands and, her dad was proud to find, knock the hell out of a baseball. Gary grew impatient. One collect call wouldn't hurt, so at 8:15, he dialed. No answer. Soon his unit took off on a warrior run, where soldiers would go as far as they could, just to see if they could do it. At least the run occupied Gary's mind. He finished, then he talked with some friends. Even laughed a little. Back to the phone around 11. No answer. That gymnastics show must be running late, he thought. At 2:30, Gary Eastburn began to worry in earnest. Jana was supposed to be taking a nap this time of day. Whenever Gary was late getting Jana home for her afternoon nap, Katie lectured him. She was religious about the afternoon nap. By 6 o'clock, Gary thought of calling the next-door neighbors, but he could not for the life of him remember the Seafelt's name. He considered calling the police, but said no, nothing bad had happened. He called Dale Johnson, a sergeant who worked for him at Pope Air Force Base, and asked Dale to take a look around the house. He called back to say no one was home. "Well, call the sheriff's department and get them to leave a message," Gary said. Deputy Brenda Price woke up Robert Seafelt. "Have you seen anything unusual next door?" Seafelt groused, trying to shake off sleep. He squinted into the deputy's headlights as he looked into his driveway. "No, I haven't noticed," he said. Gary's roommate at the airbase came over to console him. "Hey, look, there's some telephone problems or something," he said. "Don't worry about it and go to sleep." Gary took that advice. Maybe Katie and the kids spent the night at a friend's. The next day, he'd find his family, and he and Kitty would laugh about this. Gary spent most of the morning chasing cadets off the phone. The call came that afternoon. He couldn't wait to hear Katie's explanation. "Gary, it's for you," someone said. "There she is," Gary said, as he moved toward the phone. "It's some detective." Gary knew then. If it had been just a car wreck, a detective wouldn't be the one to call. He grabbed the receiver, his life, as he knew it, crashing to an end. "Are any of them alive?" he asked. The greeting startled Detective Jack Watts. Suddenly, the man on the other end was a suspect. "There's been a death in the family," Watts said. "You need to come home." "Can you tell me who?" "I just can't tell you. There's been a death in the family, and you need to get home right away." Gary put the phone on the hook and staggered down the hall. "What's wrong?" a voice said. Gary collapsed into a ball. "My wife and kids are dead." His friends threw some of his things into a suitcase. The school's vice commander, who'd spent 7 years as a prisoner of war in Vietnam, came by and wept harder than Gary. The chaplain, just off the phone with Detective Watts, offered the only comfort he could. "The baby's still alive," he told Gary. Gary and his roommate packed up and drove to the Montgomery airport. They bought the last two seats on the last flight out. Gary sank into his seat, surrounded by a plane full of sons and daughters flying home after Mother's Day visits. The flight landed in Atlanta, where Gary waited 2 hours to change planes. Passersby tried not to stare, but Captain Gary Eastburn was making quite a scene, sipping beer between long, loud sobs. He remembered how she was that day on a softball field 11 years ago. Kathryn Furnish, 20 years old and engaged to her college boyfriend, had to be talked into going to the singles club softball game in Westwood, Kansas, a tiny town among the suburbs of Kansas City. Katie hadn't tried softball Little League, but a high school friend told her it'd be something to do on another slow night. Gary Eastburn, 25 years old and tired of selling shoes at Montgomery Ward, never passed up a softball game. He'd never been to a singles club either, but a friend talked him into it. If they played softball, he figured, it couldn't be all bad. He sought out the girl in a ponytail and cut-off jeans during post-game beers. She let him take her home. A week later, they arranged to meet at another softball game. This time, Katie sat and watched him hit 2 homers and a triple and drive in 7 runs. Gary Eastburn never played better. He was in love. On one trip around the bases, he glanced into the stands. He was sure he had impressed her now, but she looked bored. Later, Gary leaned over to kiss her goodnight. "There's something I need to tell you," Katie said. "Yeah, what's that?" "I'm kind of engaged to this guy." She and her boyfriend had been shopping for rings while at Kansas State University. He had gone home for the summer and promised to call every week. A deflated Gary Eastburn drove home, at first resigned that he met her too late. But then he pounded the steering wheel. "I'm not going to give up on this," he thought. He dropped by Katie's parents' house after work on Fridays and took her on drives through the countryside on Sundays, his only day off. Her parents wondered at first what she saw in this shoe salesman, but he made them like him. He made sure to scoop seconds of Jane Furnish's cooking every time he sat at her dinner table. He took tomatoes from the icebox and ate them like apples, praising Jean's backyard garden every time. The Furnishes made a nice family life, one he wanted to be a part of. Jean made a good living as a livestock broker. Jane stayed home and had dinner ready when her husband got off work. The family ate together and went to St. Agnes Parish, where the children were baptized and learned the catechism. Katie was the oldest of 4, a bashful child who suffered through Girl Scouts at her parents' urging. Her best friend was her sister Susie, a year younger. She helped her parents take care of Patty, a deaf sister 3 years younger, and Tim, 16 years younger. Katie rode the horses at her father's stockyards whenever she got a chance. She often asked for a pony for Christmas, but the furnished backyard on their suburban street was hardly the place to keep one. "When I grow up, the first thing I'm going to buy is a horse," she told her mother. She did have 3 chickens she got as an Easter present, and the family always had bird dogs and cats. Her parents wouldn't let her have a dog of her own until she was old enough to buy it. She saved babysitting money for Pepper, a black poodle she trimmed and loved for years. Katie's classmates and teachers remember a shy, bright girl who got along with everybody and was a straight arrow, even by Catholic high school standards. She didn't drink or even swear, as far as anyone could remember. Her first date was the prom, where she went with a boy who worked with her at the dime store. She was vice president of the school's knitting and crocheting club. Katie, a B-plus student, graduated in 1971 and headed off to Kansas State, 100 miles to the west and much farther from home than she wanted to live. If it had been up to her, she'd have stayed home, like most of her classmates. The Furnishes were frugal, common-sense folk, and Gary Eastburn was made to feel at home. His parents in Independence, Missouri, had split up when he was 12, forcing his mother, a cashier at Safeway, to work long hours to keep the family going. Gary never got along with his stepfather. His childhood was okay. High school football at Harry Truman High School, lots of girlfriends through school, and a stint in the Navy. But it was nothing like the Furnish home, and that's what he craved. He had to have Katie. He figured if he played it right, the fiancé would blow it. One day, Katie's fiancé called while Gary was sitting beside her on the Furnish's living room couch. Katie excused herself and returned a couple minutes later. "What is it?" Gary asked, bracing himself. "He gave me an ultimatum," she said. "It was either you or him."
"Oh, what did you say?"
"Well, I hung up the phone." They were married less than a year later at St. Agnes. Gary enrolled at the University of Missouri a few weeks after the wedding, and Katie worked as a dietitian to put him through school. She didn't mind the work, but she did mind Gary playing softball and gallivanting with college friends. The frustrations would build and build until they erupted in arguments over the simplest of things, Gary forgetting to take out the garbage or letting the dishes pile up. They tried talking. They tried counseling. But nothing helped as much as Katie getting pregnant. Kara was born on May 21, 1979, 1 week after her father graduated from college. "You know how some children say they want to grow up to be a fireman?" Gary said. "I always wanted to grow up and be a husband and father." By that time, Gary had decided to make the military his career. After learning there was more money in air traffic controlling than pharmaceutical sales, the path his major at Missouri was taking him. At least, he told Katie, he'd be home at night. Kara became her daddy's girl. She followed him around, doing whatever he was doing. She could find his favorite fishing spot. If Gary called his friend John, then he was John to Kara, too. The pranks she pulled used to crack him and Katie up as soon as they got behind closed doors. She once used a water hose to top off the fuel tank at home until it ran over. Gary paid $60 to fix it and told Kara she'd have to do household chores until she repaid him. She swept pine needles off the back porch. When she finished, Gary put 2 quarters in a jar, the start of the fuel tank fund. 10 minutes later, Kara came back and asked if she could sweep it again for another 50 cents. He constantly fretted over his firstborn. Shortly after Kara was born, Gary read an article on sudden infant death syndrome. He got up 2 to 3 times during the night and stood by her bed to make sure she was breathing. From that point on, his daughters always slept with the bedroom door open. The military shuffled them around, just as Katie feared it would. Right after Kara was born, he was stationed in Goldsboro, North Carolina for 17 months, then Wichita Falls, Texas, where Erin was born. Lots of kids lived in the neighborhood, and while the children played, Katie and the other young mothers would stand outside and chat until dark. Katie wept when Gary was transferred back to Eastern North Carolina. But Fort Bragg wasn't nearly as bad as they'd heard, and Gary became chief of air traffic control at Pope Air Force Base. Jana was born there on July 15, 1983. And in December 1984, they rented a house for $400 a month at 367 Summer Hill, an upper-middle-class subdivision just off the base. They were starting to make some money. Gary talked of fulfilling Katie's lifelong dream of buying a farm and raising a horse for the children. On the plane, Gary looked at photos of his family. There was Erin, brown eyes sparkling underneath a head full of platinum blonde hair. Kara was cute, but Erin was beautiful. Erin was also helpless, so dependent, always wanting a hug, so unlike her older sister. She'd dance around the house in her favorite dress, twirling so it would flow all around her, or prance about in her purple dance tights she got for Christmas. Erin clung to her fun bear when she slept. Kara could talk her into anything. Erin let Kara cut her hair an inch above her ears with paper-cutting scissors, and once talked her into drinking beer from a keg left over from a party the night before. Erin would play in the front yard and call, "Daddy, Daddy!" when she was stuck in a tree in the front yard, hanging onto a limb with both hands with all her might, even though she was just 6 inches off the ground. "I should never have left them," Gary murmured. "I never should have left." He thought back to that cold February morning at the school bus stop. He had bent over to hug and kiss Kara, and he kept watching her as she walked down the aisle of the bus. He waved goodbye as it pulled off. Something about it was sad even then. So sad that Gary decided to let Erin sleep rather than say goodbye. The last time he'd left for just a few days, Erin had cried. Gary didn't want to see her cry again. The plane landed around 11 p.m. Gary climbed in an Air Force car and asked to see his daughter. Instead, he was taken to the Cumberland County Sheriff's Department, where Detective Watts questioned him until 2 a.m. about his marriage. Detective Biddle took Gary's roommate from Alabama into another room to check his story against Gary's. Before he could visit his daughter, Gary provided head and pubic hair samples to compare against those found in the house. Finally, free to go, Gary's voice shook. "Can I see Jana now?" he asked. Jana had been taken to Womack Army Hospital on Fort Bragg, dehydrated from 3 nights without food or water. Jeanette Seafelt had been in charge of the toddler ever since Toman rescued her from the crib. The two of them had held each other tightly, reaching a silent agreement. No one would separate them. Jeanette had first cleaned her up and put her in one of Bob's T-shirts. Then she'd fed her some crackers. Jana's teeth had turned black from lack of nutrition. "Am I doing the right thing?" she asked one of the rescue workers. "You're doing fine." Jana threw up the crackers. It'd be a while before her stomach could handle the shock of food. Jeanette hugged Jana some more, telling her she was sorry, so sorry. William Huggins sized up the two of them and realized he couldn't take Jana to the hospital without Jeanette. They rode together in the back. Huggins peeked behind him as he drove to Womack. Jana's eyes were glazed, still reeling from shock. Huggins wondered what she'd seen. Jeanette stayed with Jana at the hospital, soothing her and walking her around the room. That night would be the first night of 5 they would spend together. When Gary arrived later that night, he found Jana with an IV hooked to her arm, bags drooping below her eyes. His daughter didn't recognize him. The doctors told him that had Jana been in the crib another 2 hours, Gary would have lost her too. The next day, Watts asked Gary to sort through the unopened mail from his house. "Don't let it be there," he said quietly. But it was. The card for the mother of his children. The card in which he had told Katie how much he loved her on this Mother's Day. The nightmare kept getting worse. Watts was the first to tell Gary that the killer had slashed his children's throats, probably while they slept. Katie, they said, had been raped.
Gary, we need you to go through the house to see what's missing, Watts said.
That was the last place Gary Eastburn wanted to go. He sat quietly as the detective turned onto Summerhill and stopped in the driveway at the seventh house on the right. The smell of blood hit Gary as soon as he stepped inside.
He got here after 9 o'clock, Watts said as they went inside, but not too late.
He told Gary they'd determined that Katie, still in her jeans and blouse, was folding clothes when the killer arrived. There had been no break-in. Gary Eastburn remembered 9 p.m. Thursday night only too well. He sat in his dorm room, studying for one of his last tests at officer school, when he had a sudden urge to call home. He started toward the hall phone, but changed his mind. Katie would be calling on Saturday. He could wait that long. Gary slowly began his tour through the house that was no longer a home. The kitchen was the same as ever. He ducked underneath a mobile made from seashells and looked at the refrigerator door, covered with his children's art. Their moving date was circled on a calendar above the counter. Gary moved on through the dining room, past Jana's wooden high chair, and into the living room. The fireplace hearth still had its padded cloth, protecting the children from sharp corners. A Nerf ball rested in front of the television. Randy the hobby horse, a toy Katie's dad had built for her, was in the corner. The rape had begun here. Marks on Katie's wrists suggested she'd been tied up while held at bay with a knife. Her shoes were on the floor, still tied. Her shirt had been ripped open. Two missing buttons were found on the carpet. Her bra had been cut at the center and pushed to the side. Her jeans had been pulled off and her panties cut. Gary imagined what it must have been like for his Katie as a man began attacking her in the living room. If she had struggled, she had been quickly overpowered. Only the basket of clothes had been knocked over. A few feet away was a page from a coloring book, a picture of a little girl riding a hobby horse. The ID techs had found the rubber glove tip back toward the dining room hallway. Gary winced as he headed toward the hallway, leading to the bedrooms. No one was sure which one the killer had chosen first. The children, possibly awakened by what was going on, were eliminated for no reason other than because they were witnesses. That Erin would wind up in her parents' room was not surprising, Gary thought. She often went to bed in his and Katie's room, so she and her older sister wouldn't giggle all night. After she drifted off, he or Katie would carry her to her own bed. Erin's fun bear lay on the floor by her bed, no longer a comfort to anyone. Paper cutouts of green and yellow balloons still hovered over Kara's bed, which was now stripped of its bloody spread. Gary turned and went toward the back, the master bedroom. The worst part. The detectives had tried to cover the bloody spots, but he saw them. The killer chased Katie back here. She must have run across the bed before getting trapped on the other side. Poor Katie, he thought. There was nowhere else to go. Oh, God, how she must have struggled. Did he make her watch him kill Erin? Gary knew Katie would not have died without fighting for her life and her family's. How could someone do this to my girls? Gary walked around the bedroom and the master bath. The luminol marks were still there, white marks on the bedroom light switch and on the bathroom sink. Gary wanted out. As he turned back to the hall, he had a flash of Kara and Erin chasing each other, laughing as they fell to the floor. "Careful, girls, you're going to get hurt," he said to children only he could see. He staggered into the hallway, as the killer had done 5 days before. He leaned against the wall. God, how can this be happening? He rubbed his forehead and closed his eyes tight. When he opened them, Kara and Erin were no longer laughing. He gasped. Luminol stained the wall inches away. As he looked around, There were luminol smears on both sides of the hall. More on Jana's door. Gary took a deep breath and pushed open Jana's door. He imagined the killer hovering at her crib, brooding over whether to raise his knife again. Gary couldn't take it anymore. He had to get out. The same image kept coming back, over and over. Katie running into the bedroom until, pitifully, she tripped and it was over. I would bet my last dollar her dying thought was, "My God, whatever happened to my kids?"
"Is anything missing?" Watts asked.
Gary noticed just a few items. A metal lockbox that held the family insurance documents and other important papers was gone. About $300 of Christmas money had been taken from Katie's panty drawer, and her wallet was stolen. Gary said his wife kept her bank machine card in her wallet. Jack Watts thought that wasn't much of a robbery. His thoughts turned to other motives. "Did your wife say anything to you about getting rid of the dog?" Watts asked Gary. He tried the question again. Gary thought about it. Katie had written letters to her mother and Gary the night before she was killed, telling them about finding a home for Dixie, their beloved setter. She had planned to find Dixie a home as soon as Gary left, but after the late-night phone call, Katie had kept Dixie around as long as she could. Gary thought about the pictures of 9-month-old Kara asleep on a blanket on the floor, Dixie resting her head on Kara's legs. He and Katie had agreed to advertise Dixie in the Beeline Grab Bragg, a Trading Post newspaper on Fort Bragg. English setter, 5 years old, spayed. No papers, $10. 867-8542. A nice man came and got Dixie, the letter said. Chapter 4. Tim Hennis was foraging through the cabinet for peanut butter for a sandwich. The television news blared from the living room, his wife, Angela, leaning forward from the couch in anticipation. The 27-year-old Army sergeant had his lunch break timed just right. In an hour and a half, he could make the 20-minute drive home from Fort Bragg, get some lunch, spend time with Angela and their baby daughter, Christina, now 2.5 months, and make 1 o'clock formation at work. Today, Angela was fired up about the midday news. She'd heard bulletins throughout the morning promoting a big break in that awful murder case she'd been reading about for 3 days. "Hey, buddy, come look at this." The two called each other buddy, starting right after they got married. Tim said something Angela didn't like, and she responded with a finger-wagging lecture. "Hey, look, buddy, don't you tell me."
"Hey, buddy, don't you tell me."
Back and forth it went, until the argument ended in a fit of laughter. From then on, they called each other buddy, a name that, by May 15, 1985, they had managed to stretch a few syllables. Angela was expecting to hear that the Cumberland County Sheriff's Department had solved the case. Jack Watts was starting to feel like maybe he was about to. Patrick Cohn remembered the man he saw walking in the Eastburn driveway well enough to put together a composite. Cohn even complained at first that the jawline was not square enough, the eyes not droopy enough, and the nose not flared enough. The eyes and nose were fixed to his satisfaction, but the jawline still bothered him. Watts was ecstatic that Cohn could harp on such detail. Tim and Angela Hennis listened as the news anchor read a public announcement from the Sheriff's Department. "They are looking for a white male who came to the Eastburn residence last Tuesday, May 7th, 1985, in the early evening and picked up a white English setter bird dog with liver spots. The dog's name is Dixie. It is believed that this man also owns a Spitz dog. It is believed this person was driving a small white Chevrolet Chevette automobile. We would request this person come forward." Tim Hennis dropped his sandwich and turned pale. "God, buddy, they're looking for you," Angela finally said. "We've got a call down there." Hennis, a parachute rigger, called his boss and told him he would be late coming back from lunch. Then he called the sheriff's department and said he was on his way. The dog had seemed like such a good idea. Ever since the baby had been born, Snowball had been jealous, yapping constantly in the backyard and running wild in the house. Angela saw an ad for an English setter in the Beeline Grab Rag. As a boy, Tim had an English setter he adored. He remembered how good Ginger was with kids. His dad would take Ginger on hunting trips, and she'd rustle up pheasants. Tim wanted a dog like that for Christina. Angela called and left a message with the babysitter. When Katie Eastburn called back, Tim answered. Katie told him that, yes, the dog was good with children. They were getting rid of Dixie because the family was moving to England. They wanted to find a home soon. "I'll come tonight if it's all right," Tim said. "Yeah, that'll be good, because the children will be in bed." Hennis took down directions to the house. Katie told him she'd leave her porch light on. Hennis went to the first house with a porch light, discovered it was the wrong one, and continued until he found the Eastburn home. Katie apologized for the way the house looked, saying she'd just gotten the children to bed so they wouldn't be awake when Dixie left them. Hennis looked around. Typical for someone living with small children, he thought. Things were scattered about the floor, over and above the mother's best efforts. They sat in the dining room and talked. She said her husband was out of town and would soon return for the move to England. They weren't sure the dog could survive the quarantine. She would rather find a good home for her than put her through that, even though the kids would miss her terribly. "I really don't want any money for Dixie," she said. "That would be like selling a member of the family. I just put that in the ad to keep the cranks away. I figure if someone is willing to pay for the dog, they will more likely give it a good home." Dixie was stretched out in the doorway between the dining room and living room. Hennis went over and scratched her head. "That's a good girl." He liked Dixie, but he wasn't sure Snowball would. They agreed to get in touch later in the week to see how the dogs were getting along. Before leaving, Hennis used her bathroom, the first door on the left down the hall. Then he took the dog chain he'd brought with him, hooked it to Dixie's collar, and went out the carport door. Kathryn Eastburn followed him out and waved goodbye. Tim and Angela put their baby in their Chevette and headed downtown. In Fort Bragg, the memorial service for Katie and the girls was getting ready to begin at the Pope Air Force Base Chapel. About 200 friends, family, and military would attend the half-hour service. A friend of Gary's would read from the Book of Job. Watts wanted to go, but he needed to keep working the case. As he returned from lunch, Tim and Angela Hennis and their baby were sitting in the waiting room. Watts's jaw dropped. "My God, he's a dead ringer for Cone's composite," he thought. A blonde, hulking, 6'4" soldier sat before him, complete with mustache, sleepy eyes, and flared nose, just as Patrick Cone had insisted the day before. "Is he a suspect?" Angela asked after introductions. "No, he's not," Watts answered. "We just want to find out what information he has. He was one of the last people to see Mrs. Eastburn alive, and maybe he saw or heard something that will help us. Also, we'd like to get some physical samples from him for elimination purposes." Watts escorted Hennis to his office, leaving Angela behind. Then he read Tim his Miranda rights and asked him to sign a waiver saying he didn't want a lawyer present. "Before I do this, I need to know if I'm a suspect," Tim said. "It's like I told you, you are not a suspect. We just need to talk to you because you were one of the last people to see Mrs. Eastburn alive." "Okay, then," Hennis said. "Why am I waiving my rights?" "Just a routine procedure," Watts said. He measured Hennis's body language, his folded arms, the way he distanced himself from him. Watts thought him to be hostile. During breaks in the questioning, Hennis joined Angela and Christina in the waiting room. Newspaper and television reporters with cameras had learned the man with the dog had come forward. "Did you know Mrs. Eastburn?" one asked. "Are you under arrest?" Hennis tried to ignore them, but they kept asking. He said no comment and retreated to Watts's office. Watts used these breaks to put together a photo lineup. He needed a photo of Hennis. "Bet he's got a record," Watts said to himself. He looked in the department's mugshot file and found a 2-year-old mug of Hennis stemming from a bounced check. "So he spends money he doesn't have," Watts thought. He found photos of five other blonde males with mustaches to fill out the lineup. Then he took Hennis's statement, an account of his actions from May 9th to May 12th. Hennis talked as Watts clumsily typed along. Hennis said he had dropped his wife off at Selma, 90 minutes away, on Thursday, May 9th, so she could be with her parents for Mother's Day weekend. He said that because he had CQ duty on Friday and Sunday night. They would not be together anyway. CQ duty was a 24-hour shift at the barracks when somebody had to be in charge of quarters in case a supervisor was needed in the middle of the night. Hennis said he returned to Fayetteville without Angela and went to bed early, shortly after the woman who had given him the dog called to see if Dixie was working out. A normal workday on Friday, Hennis recalled, then CQ duty that night. He cleaned up around the house on Saturday, then CQ duty on Sunday. He picked up Angela on Monday.
Home alone the night of the murders, Watts thought.
He asked Hennis if he would mind going upstairs to the jail, where a nurse would take hair and blood samples. Hennis said sure. The television cameras followed. Upon entering the jail, they passed a sign that said, "No weapons beyond this point."
"I don't think I'm supposed to have this up here," Hennis said,
pulling a folding buck knife from his pocket. Watts kept the knife and marched Hennis to the nurse's station, past prisoners in orange jumpsuits. He asked Hennis to give physical samples he thought would match those found inside 367 Summer Hill. Not only were there hair, blood, and fingerprints found at the house, but during the autopsy, a medical examiner in Chapel Hill had retrieved a semen sample with a large number of spermatozoa intact. Hennis completed the standard rape kit. He combed and pulled his head and pubic hairs. He spat a sample of saliva. He allowed blood to be drawn. Hennis asked again if he were a suspect, and Watts said no. The detective was stalling Hennis until an SBI fingerprint expert could drive 65 miles from Raleigh to get his fingerprints. While Hennis was being detained by Watts, Robert Biddle and the SBI's Joel Morris brought Patrick Cohn downtown to see the photo lineup. If Cohn made a hit, Watts could lay to rest the whole MacDonald copycat theory picking up steam throughout the community. Sheriff Otis Jones could make political hay. This wasn't a botched army investigation like the MacDonald case, he would say, but the work of detectives with the Cumberland County Sheriff's Department. "Can you identify any of those pictures?" Biddle asked Cohn inside Morris's car. Cohn knew whoever he fingered would be branded a triple murderer and stand trial for his life. He didn't know it was going to be this hard. It had been dark that night. He had passed them briefly. Why had he gotten involved? He remembered telling his dad how he had volunteered to become an eyewitness. "Son," his father said, "you're going to regret the day you ever got involved in that case." Cohn looked at the six pictures. Then he stared out the window and prayed. The pictures again. Out the window. He prayed harder. This went on for quite some time. Finally, Cohn made his choice.
"Number 5 has his nose, but it's number 2.
Biddle asked him to cover the foreheads of the suspects as if they were wearing a toboggan cap.
"Number 2 again," Cohn said. "I'm certain that's the man."
He was looking at a photo of Tim Hennis. Morris cruised through the law enforcement center's parking lot. Biddle asked Cohn if he recognized any of the cars.
"That's it over there," he said, pointing to Hennis's Chevette.
Biddle raced inside, called Watts, and blurted,
"We've got a hit."
Cohn knew he had pleased the officers. They took him home and thanked him again for his time. Watts labored through the rest of his interview with Tim Hennis, triple murderer. Ricky Navarro of the SBI in Raleigh finally arrived and took his fingerprints. Watts said he was finished and showed Hennis outside, 6 hours after he had waived his rights.
"Get that camera out of my face," Hennis growled,
as he and Angela pushed Christina's stroller across the lot. Hennis covered his face. A reporter asked Watts if this was a suspect, and Watts' answer changed to no comment. He showed Hennis to his car,
the white Chevette that Cohen had spotted, and watched while he folded up Christina's stroller and put it in the back. Then Watts bid Hennis a cordial goodbye. Tim climbed in and drove off. What a weird one, Hennis thought. He was angry and felt like he and Angela had not been treated well. He couldn't wait to get home and call his father. He wouldn't believe what happened. We got a dog from a lady, and she was murdered, he told Bob Hennis in Boca Raton, Florida. Tim said he'd given Watts everything he could about the lady. Hey, the whole thing will blow over, Bob told him. He and his wife, Mary Lou, went to bed thinking little of it. Tim and Angela didn't bother watching the 11 o'clock news, where they would have seen themselves shielding from the camera, trying to get Christina out of there. The anchor said he wasn't a suspect. They went to bed, trying to put the experience behind them. Across town, at the district attorney's office, three parties were invited to a law enforcement skull session. The Cumberland County Sheriff's Department, represented by Sheriff Jones, Watts, and others, wanted to arrest Tim Hennis immediately and announce the case had been solved. The department had been unusually eager for an arrest to get this unsolved crime out of the newspaper. The district attorney's office was represented by William Van Story IV, the assistant who would get the case. His recommendation was to wait. The SBI's senior agent in Fayetteville joined Van Story's vote. Sheriff Jones prevailed, though. As the county sheriff, he arrested who he wanted. If the guy's a murderer, he argued, why not get him off the streets before sunrise? After the arrest, the prosecutors could do what they wanted with the case. Sheriff Jones would have done his job by then. Watts got warrants from a magistrate, and at 1 a.m., he and Otis Jones drove to Lombardy Drive, backed by a half dozen other deputies and SBI agents. Somebody's beating on our damn door, Angela said, trying to rouse her husband. Tim awoke, irritated and undressed. He'd been sound asleep. Who's there? He growled. This is the police. We have a warrant for your arrest. Come on out. Open the door. Tim ran back to his bedroom and put on an orange Nike t-shirt and Levi's. When he opened the door, the cops had their guns drawn. Angela burst into tears. Get my dad on the phone, quick, Tim told her. Angela dialed, then handed Tim the phone. Mom, you better get dad. They're arresting me. Chapter 5. Bob Hennis shifted in his seat as the Piedmont jet took off. He shut his eyes and tried, as always, to sleep off another flight. What am I getting into now? He wondered. His oldest child and only living son was behind bars in Fayetteville, charged with murdering a young woman and two children. Bob had heard the tremor in Tim's voice, a bad sign. Tim never showed his feelings. 7 hours earlier, the phone call had shattered another peaceful South Florida night at his and Mary Lou's home, the culmination of all he'd worked for in 31 years with IBM. The house had four sets of French doors leading onto a series of decks and patios beside a swimming pool. The doors leading from their bedroom to a deck outside were open the night of May 15th, allowing a gentle breeze inside. Mary Lou groped around and found the phone first. She was too groggy to make sense of what she was hearing. Give me your social security number, she muttered. Mom, you have it, Tim said. This was not the response Tim had expected. But Mary Lou woke just as Tim vanished from the phone line, replaced by Angela's hysterical, "They're arresting him! They're arresting him!" It's going to be all right, Bob said from another extension. They won't hurt Tim. Is he calm? To his surprise, the next voice he heard was Tim's. Dad, they're all over the house. They've arrested me. Then the voice stopped. Tim's brief phone privilege had ended.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.